Romans chapter 5, the first two verses. That's where we will. Now, I found out a very good tradition where people stand as they read the Word of God. Can we adapt that? Just stand wherever we are for the reading of God's Word. As we read it together, louder, and with understanding, as we allow God to minister to us. Let's go. Number one. Says, I'm writing this before I come because I long to come to you. so that I can do some impartation or impart into you a spiritual gift. He says, I have desired many times to come to you, but I have been hindered. How many people know that you may desire many things, but you are hindered? It's possible, isn't it? He was hindered to go to Rome, so he writes to them and gives this letter to Phoebe, who is one of the colleagues in the ministry, to take this letter to Rome, telling them that I am coming. Meanwhile, he has collected some alms from the church in Corinth so that he can take back to Jerusalem for the people that are needy before he goes to Spain for travel. When he's writing to them, first of all, he introduces himself, because Paul always introduces himself in his letters. And some of you from our years would know when you're starting a letter, you introduce yourself, isn't it? This generation does not know the art of letter writing. But for my generation, I used to write a lot of letters for my grandmom. Before she starts dictating the words, she will tell you, have you finished the salutation? Because a whole page should be greetings. Greetings from me. My grandmom is called Rebecca. So he says, but after that, I would like you to tell you a few things. So you only tell her, I am ready, after you finish the salutation. It was a standard kind of salutation. And Paul has standard salutation. He always tells them, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, like he starts this letter, or he says, a servant or a slave of Jesus Christ, or he can say, a bond servant. So that is the manner in which he introduces himself. And always he tells the churches how he prays for them. If you read the letter to the Philippians, to the Colossians, like Ephesians chapter 1 verse 15 says, since I heard of your love for the saints and your faith in God, I cease not to make mention of you in my prayers, praying for you, thanking God for you, and making mention of you in my prayers. So he tells the church that he's been praying for them. After he has finished his introduction in the book to the Romans, he tells them about the gospel, that we were lost, but now we were found, because God has sent his Son to die for us. And what he has done is so powerful, because Jesus came and died for us so that we can receive the remission of our sin. And that is what we call the gospel. Hallelujah. And he tells them in verse 16 of chapter 1 that I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is power to us that brings salvation, isn't it? First to the Jews and then to the Gentiles. In chapter 1, he talks about the pagans, who are the heathen. He says that these people were given a free choice, but they did not use their free choice to choose God. Instead, they chose to walk in their own ways. They deserted the God that created them and chose to worship idols. And scripture says, now they chose to worship the creation rather than the creator, he that created them. And because of that, God has given them to unrighteousness. There are three things that Paul tells the church that God gave them. If you do not turn to God, God gives you a way to three things. Number one, he tells them that God gave them to uncleanliness. So they walk therefore after the lust of their heart. That their heart is full of lust, they do not have self-control, they are doing things that are out of the law of God. In fact, they are walking in iniquity. Number two, he says, God has given them to vile affections or vile passions. Now they have passions that are not normal. He tells them that men are now lusting after other men, and women are lusting after women. Their affections are not normal. They are gone beyond the normal constraints of humans. The third thing Paul tells them is that God has given them over to depraved minds or debased minds. They are now not thinking straight. And if you look at the world around us, you think that you see that so many people are not thinking straight, isn't it? You look at the news, people killing each other, people killing the wife, the children, things because people are not thinking straight. They are depraved or the best mind. A debased mind is that which is on the ground, the dust, isn't it? You're below yourself. The Bible tells us that the prodigal son had a debased mind. That is why when he came to his senses, he turned back to God. Hallelujah. Amen. So chapter 1 is talking about Gentiles, all the pagans. And because he's writing to a mixed church, I told you this church has Gentiles and has Jews. Come on, go with me. It has Jews, isn't it? When he's talking about pagans and he tells them that they are lost, they have left God, the Jews will be clapping and say, oh, that's right, because pagans are away from God, isn't it? Because there is a prayer every Jew used to make in the morning. A Jew would rise up in the morning and say, thank you, God, because I am not a Gentile. Thank God, I am not a woman. I'm not a Gentile because women used to stay outside the courts, isn't it? In the temple, they used to stay outside. So you would rise up in the morning and say, I am not a Gentile, and I'm not. So the Jews will be seated there clapping their hands and say, I thank God I'm not a Gentile, because they are lost. They have deprived minds, they have debased minds, they have vile affections and passions, and they are unclean. But he turns to chapter 2 and addresses the Jews. He tells them, though the Gentiles are lost, but you are also lost. You have left God. God gave you the commandments, but you are also not obeying the commandments. He tells them that it's not profitable for you that you got the commandments because you are not also obeying the commandments. You have left the commandments. And moreover, nobody is justified under the law before God. That all of us are sinners before God. He tells them that it is impossible for man to keep the law, because once you break one, you have broken the whole commandment. So don't laugh at them, because you are also sinners. And he tells them that because you have broken the law and you cannot be justified before God, you are as sinful as the pagans are. So you have nothing to boast about. You are no longer now Jews, because he tells them, a Jew is not just that that is born out of blood. A Jew is he that keeps the commandments. That's why he emphasizes that you're presenting to prove something, isn't it? Paul is trying to prove why we are justified. The same book is written like the book of Luke. The book of Luke is also a tragedy because Luke wrote the book of Luke and Acts, because Acts is a continuation of the book of Luke. In fact, Luke, when he starts to write his letter, he says, for as much as many have tried to set in order the things that happened among us, of those things, the people that wrote those things were eyewitnesses and ministers. Luke continues to say that I have also determined to set in order. That means to write chronologically. That is why if you look at the book of Luke, he writes chronologically the events of Jesus. He says, I have written chronologically, O excellent Theophilus, because that letter was supposed to be handed over to Theophilus for a presentation to a case. Okay? So it's an argument to be presented somewhere. And when you start the book of Acts, he says, of the former things have I written to you, O most excellent Theophilus. Meaning, he's starting from where he had began in the book of Acts. So Romans, the book of Romans, takes the same form. He's writing to Romans to prove to them something. So chapter 1 is talked about the pagans. Chapter 2 is talking about the Jews. Now chapter 3, he tells us that the pagans have broken the law and they are lost. And the Jews have broken the law. Chapter 3 now tells us all of us have broken the law. That's why the summary is in Romans 3:23, says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory. Are we still together? Did I lose some of you? So he says, all have sinned and fallen short of. He says that the Jews receive the commandments, but They went away of the law. The pagans also have gone away of the law. So all have sinned. Man has inherited the sin of Adam. And therefore, man has no recourse other than only that which God can give him. Okay? Then he goes to verse 4. He goes to verse 4 and gives us an example, because a good teacher in the presentation must give us an example. A case study, isn't it? Isn't it? Gives us a case study. He says, now, consider your father Abraham. To understand what I am telling you, Abraham believed God and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. Because his righteousness was not of works. It is not that he did something special to be called righteous. But God imputed into righteousness to Abraham because of himself. Because Abraham believed God, it was not of his works. And Abraham, being 100 years and Sarah 90 years, could not give or sire a child. But yet they believed on God. The Bible says they staggered not at the promise of God, but believed that he who had promised was also able to bring it to pass. Amen. And so they believed God, and it was imputed unto them righteousness. And he gives an example. If somebody believes God because of works, then what he receives is not grace, because he receives a reward. That reward is wages, isn't it? Because if you work, when you are paid, it is not a favor. It is wages, isn't it? But if you do not work and somebody pays you, then it becomes a favor, which is grace. So to Abraham, it was grace, because the Jews were boasting that because we are from our father Abraham, then we automatically have grace. But he was telling them, the grace that God gives you is a favor from him. It is not what you have done. I came to tell you this morning, you are not where you are because of something you have done. It is not because you have prayed, or you read the Bible, or you pray and fast. Everything is about grace. You are where you are because of the imputed grace of God. That's why scripture says no one should boast. There is no saint under the voice of the sound of my voice who should boast and say, I am a good Christian. I'm the one who has fasted. I'm the one who has prayed. I'm a good at Bible reading. No! Everything we have is by grace. Amen. Ephesians 2:8 says, because you are saved by grace through faith. It is not of your doing. It is not of your works, lest anybody should boast. No Christian has earned the right to boast. Because all we have and all that we are is by grace. After talking about that in verse chapter 4, he ends that chapter in verse 25 by telling him, because Jesus was delivered to death for our offenses and raised up to life for our justification. We are justified because of Jesus' resurrection. Then he moves to chapter 5, which we have now read. But before we look at the two verses there, chapter 5 talks about two Adams. The first Adam at the Garden of Eden, and the second Adam, who is Jesus Christ. He says death came through the first Adam, but life has come through the second Adam. Condemnation came through the first Adam, but through the second Adam we have been set free. So we are not living the old order. We are under a new order. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Are you still here?
Yes.
Because it's cold and you have to encourage yourself, right? But chapter 6 talks about righteousness. He says now we are not under the law, but we are under grace. What we are walking in is under grace. Because we have a newness of life. We are not where we used to. Because God has made us holy. He that sinned, he that dies is no longer under the law. That is what scripture tells us in Romans 6. He that dies is no longer under the law. Chapter 7 talks about the law and the grace. In fact, he starts by saying, who among you? And he says, I'm talking to those who understand the law. If a woman is still in marriage, she is bound by the law. That means under the authority of the husband. But as long as the husband is dead, that woman is free to marry whoever she likes, isn't it? Hello? If she is still married, the husband is alive, she's under the law. She cannot marry any other person. Because anytime she leaves that husband, it is termed as divorce, a contradiction of the law, isn't it? But it's not talking about marriage, because he continues to explain, you also, as long as you're under the law and you are alive, you are still under the operation of the law. But when you die, the law has no more effect on you. Now you are under a completely different marriage, which is called grace. Hallelujah. That is why the death of yourself is the most important thing that can happen in the life of a Christian. Because once you die to self, you are no longer under the law, but you are under the grace. So your husband, who is self, dies. Who is the law, dies. And you now start living a free life. And he gives us an example of himself. He tells us that that which I want to do, I do not do. But I find myself doing that which I do not want to do. Because the law of sin and death is within me. So I think about doing the right thing, but I don't find myself doing it. Because there is another law at work inside of me, which is the law of sin and death. So I find myself doing what I have not planned. Is that familiar to somebody here? Now what you plan to do, you say, this week I will not lie. But you find yourself doing that, because there is another law inside of you. And he said, who unto me, who shall help me and take me out of this captivity? And he says, thank God for Jesus Christ. Because there is a solution for you. I've come to tell you there is a solution for you. Because there's a different regime of life that God has already made accessible for you. That is why after that he transitions to chapter 8 to talk about a life that is led by the Spirit. This chapter talks about the Holy Spirit more than any other chapter, being led of the Spirit. He says, there's now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. He says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Jesus Christ has set me free from the law of sin and death. For that which the law would not do, because my flesh was weak, God has sent his Son Jesus Christ in the likeness of the flesh and of sin, to condemn sin and flesh, so that the righteousness of the law can be fulfilled in those who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And he tells us, continues to talk about, those who are led, verse 14, by the Spirit are the children of God. Verse 16 says, now we have received the Spirit of adoption that calls unto him and say, Abba, Abba Father. Continues to say, if we are crying to God, Abba Father, then we are heirs. And the heir joined heirs with Christ. And if we suffered with him in death, then we shall be justified with him in his resurrection. Hallelujah. Because of the Spirit-led life, that's why he says, now you no longer pray, because you cannot say, I am praying. No. He says, for the Spirit helps us in our infirmities, verse 26. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit helps us. Prays for us, isn't it? With groanings that can never be uttered. So now, we have some different kind of prayer. We do not pray like the pagans, struggling in prayer, because we avail ourselves for the Spirit to pray inside of us. For it says, he that knoweth the heart, such is the mind of God. For he prays for us in accordance to the will of God. And he says, and all things work together for what? Those who are led by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. All right, then. Because of time, we need to move there. And from chapter 9 to chapter 11, he's talking about the Jews. That he's sorrowful about the Jews. He wants these people to come back to the Lord. Because in fact, chapter 9 says, rather that they be accursed, so that his people, the Jews, can come to salvation. Then chapter 12, of course, is talking about you giving yourself as a living sacrifice to the Lord, isn't it? Holy and acceptable, the Bible says, for this is your reasonable act of she said, do not be conformed to the image of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, isn't it? That you may know what is good and what is acceptable and what is perfect will of God. He says, according to the grace of God that is given to me, I speak to every man among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but according to the measure of faith that has been given to you, and serve one another with the gift that you have. Chapter 13 talks about remembering the weak among us, helping each other, and serving the authority. And of course, he goes to 14 and 15 about the salutation. That is the summary of this book. With that little introduction, ladies and gentlemen, I now want to speak to I now want to go to the two verses that we read and glean some little truth. He says, therefore, in light of what we have discussed, being justified freely by grace, we have peace. Tell your neighbor, peace. Peace. You know, when you have peace with somebody, you like being around. You are not under condemnation, isn't it? We have peace with God. Being justified freely, what does justification mean? Justification means being absolved, being vindicated, being declared right, being just. When I say you are justified, means you are right, isn't it? When I say you are justified, means you are vindicated. There is no other penalty of sin on you. You are absolved. Justification, therefore, means that judicial declaration for a sinner, because of the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, that his sins are forgiven, the penalty of sin has been set aside, and that you'll be restored to your former position. It's as if you never sinned. That means we are going back to Eden, the garden of God, where we started, where we first started. When you are justified by God, you are returned back there. Justification is, first of all, a declaration act. That means an announcement is made. When a victim or an accused is set free, there is a declaration that is made, isn't it? Say, from today, you are no longer captive to the law, isn't it? So it's a declaration act. Secondly, it's a judicial act that God combines judgment and salvation to declare the sinner set free. Thirdly, it's a remissive act, meaning that whatever you owe has been paid. The Bible says, because of the incorruptible price that he gave for you, you are set free. Hallelujah. Amen. So you are no longer charged. There are four things I like to say, and then I close. What justification does. Firstly, justification removes the penalty of sin upon you. Because the Bible tells us in Romans 6, 6 and 7. The end of it, it says that he that has died is set free from the law. So you are no longer under the penalty of sin. Because the Bible tells us, Romans 6, 23, that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is in what? Through Jesus Christ, isn't it? So you have eternal life. The fact that you are a sinner that is supposed to die has been set aside. Romans 4, 25 says that he has been delivered to death for our offenses, and has been lifted to life for our justification. Isaiah 53 verse 5, he says, for he was wounded for our transgression, for he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. Chastisement of our peace, meaning the punishment that was due to us, has been given to Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, 21 says that God made him sin, who knew no sin, so that by him we might might be justified. He became a sinner for us to be set free. Because God, who is holy and just, cannot tolerate sin. He must punish sin. But Jesus comes to stand on our stead so that he can receive the punishment that was due to us. So a child of God can never walk in condemnation, still carrying his sin, because it has been taken away. That is why sometimes when you go to before God to confess the sin you did 5 years ago, he's asking, which one? Because he forgave you the last time you repented. The Bible says, as far as the earth is from the heavens, have I taken your sins away, isn't it? So, we have been set aside from the penalty. Secondly, we've been restored to the place of favor and grace. Justification is not just about forgiveness. It's more than pardon. It is promotion. You see, when somebody forgives you, he may forgive you and remember what he did. An employer can forgive you. That means he doesn't take you to court, but you lose your job, isn't it? But he has forgiven you. A creditor can forgive your debt, but you remain poor, isn't it? But God forgives you your debt and empowers you to be rich. God restores you to your former place of relationship with him. That's why he says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, he says, for Christ has delivered us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is a man that hangs on the tree. He says that the blessings of Abraham may come to us, the Gentiles, and we may receive the gift of the Spirit by faith. Now we are Abraham's seeds, the seed according to the promise. Verse 27, 29 says, if you've been baptized in Christ, then we have put on Christ. And if you have put on Christ, now there is no difference between the Jew and the Gentile, the male and the female. We are all one in Christ. And if we are one in Christ, we are heirs. And heirs according to the promise. God has not just forgiven your sins, he has also taken you back to the place of inheritance. Huh? You see, the religious mindset is the prodigal son mindset. He says, now I'll go back to my father and say, I'm not worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your servants. So we serve God as one of his servants. But when he came and he has that prayer, he reached, he was near the father. The father saw him at a distance because God is a different father. He's not like human being. He was opening his gate, waiting for his son to come back. When he came back, he started to confess his sin and say, I'm sorry, I did this. The father did not listen to all his prayers. Nothing he listened. He said, bring a fatted calf. Bring a ring and put it on his finger. Because he treated him as if he had never sinned. And that is our God. You see, men remember your mistakes. Men help you never to forget what you did. You know, if you went and interacted with your people in high school, that's the picture they have of you. They don't even believe you have changed. Isn't it? And let me tell you something else. Men also look, only judge you according to what they see. They think this one got a child out of wedlock. She must be very promiscuous. But you know there are promiscuous people who don't get children. But if she got a baby and came before God and said, I'm sorry, if God forgave her and has restored her, as a church, we must also help them to be restored. Amen. Amen. Because the people who need to do that does not mean that they are okay. No. Once you realize everything that you have is by grace, you don't speak very fast in the issues of people. You have some constraint, isn't it? Because you know I would be like that if not by the grace of God. It has been said the church is the only place where if you see your soldier wounded, you finish him. You don't carry him. So and so has fallen. Oh my God. And I thought she was very powerful, right? She was singing. She was all over the place. What has happened to her? If God has forgiven her and restored her, as a people, we must also
point, yeah.
Because you remember yourself where you're from, isn't it? Second thing that God does, one, we say that the penalty is set aside. Two, we say that you've been restored to grace and favor, isn't it? The third thing is that you have imputed righteousness. Imputed, now you are clean before God. It's as if you never sinned. Romans 8 verse 4, it says, for the righteous, for, so that the righteousness of the law may be fulfilled to those who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. You have been imputed with righteousness. The Bible says, and we know that all things work together for to love God and are called according to his purpose, isn't it? For those he foreknew, scripture says, he predestined, isn't it, to be conformed to the those he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, isn't it? That he might be the firstborn among many brethren. We have our firstborn ahead of us. He has set the way for us. And he said, for those he predestined, he also called. Verse 30. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. What shall we then say to this thing, brethren? If God be for us, who can be? God, who did not withhold his only son, but gave him freely with him to us, isn't it? How much more together with him shall he give us all things? For who shall condemn our sins? Scripture is asking here, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Nobody can bring a charge against you, the child of God. Because God has declared you set free and justified. That before God and before the law, you are clean. So who can condemn you? Tell your neighbor, nobody can condemn you. So let men speak whatever they want. Because God, who is the justifier, has already justified us. He has set me free. The fourth thing is that God has given you a legal standing. You know, legal standing means you have the right standing before a judicial institution, isn't it? That is the right to jurisprudence. The practice of the law, isn't it? You must be rightly standing before me. Any advocate must rightly, the judge will ask, are you rightly appearing before me? It's not that you took two courses in law and then believe that now you can stand before a judge. You must be properly prepared and passed. That apart from the judge, the classwork, you go to the Kenya School of Law, then you buy exam, then you stand, isn't it? Nobody can just stand there and say, Your Honor. Sometimes what they speak there, you can't understand. So they ask, are you rightly before me, isn't it? But God now has given us right standing with him. We can appear before God. This is liberating because now you don't need a mediator. God has given you the right standing. You don't need an archbishop, a bishop, a pastor, a reverend to go on behalf of you to God. You have the legal standing before God. You can rightly appear before God. The Bible says now we have confidence to go in his presence that we may find grace in time of need. Do you have a need? You have a legal standing to appear before God and say, Father, I need this. And it shall be delivered to you. Hallelujah. It shall be delivered. You know, most of us do not think that we have a legal standing. You know, one day I was in court for a traffic offense. And you know, some people think the pastors also have traffic offenses. Yes, we do. Sometimes you go fast, like more than you're supposed to. Sometimes, you know. So I was there, and I was well-dressed, so I just came and sat the closest bench where the lawyers were sitting, the advocates. And I was, oh, how are you? I'm a friend. I was going to understand what I said, but I said, I'm all right. When I was called, he said, Francis, yes, Your Honor. I said, oh, you are an accused.
There is nothing like freedom.